In this final session on DC machines, we'll be understanding the speed control strategies associated with DC machines. So let's first study speed control in DC shunt motors. So what are the methods that can be employed for speed control in DC shunt motors? These are broadly, we can speak, and there are the field control methods and the armature control methods. So in the field control method, you have actually the adjusting the field resistance, and second method that we employ in for speed control in DC shunt motors is adjusting the terminal armature voltage. You are supplying the armature, or DC voltage is supplied to the armature. If we vary the DC voltage input to the armature, the speed can change. Another method that may be used in DC shunt motor for speed control is inserting a resistor . So while this can be done for speed control, it is not much used. So the two control methods are involve the field resistance, adjusting the field resistance, and adjusting the terminal voltage. Now, what happens by changing the field resistance? We know the equation EA VT is equal to EA plus IARA in case of a DC shunt motor. From that we can obtain actually IA is equal to VT minus EA by RA. RA is the armature resistance, EA is actually the back EMF produced in the DC motors. IA is the armature current. Now the we know that the torque induced in the DC motor is KT times IA into flux phi. Now what we are here doing is we are changing the field resistance. By changing the field resistance, the field current will also change. That means if we increase the field resistance, as far as the field part is concerned, field current is simply equal, the field current is simply VF is equal to IF is equal to VF by RF. And the we apply the DC voltage to the field winding, we are inserting along with RF, we are having an R adjustable resistance. This R adjustable can be changed. As we increase the resistance, the field current will decrease. As the field current decreases, the flux produced will decrease as well. As the flux produced in the machine decreases, the torque induced in this case, we can say also, because of the flux, because of the decreased flux, what happens is that the induced, the back EMF, we also know that back EMF is equal to KB omega phi. So let me rewrite this. IA is VT minus E. I'll write EB instead of EA divided by RA, where EB is KB phi omega, and torque induced torque is KT I A phi. So what we are doing here is that I F is V F divided by R F plus R adjacent. So we are increasing R adjacent. We are increasing R adjacent. That means I F will decrease. As I F decreases, that means flux produced will also decrease. As flux produced decreases, the generated back EMF will also decrease. If IB decreases, that means IA will increase. So since the flux is in the machine is decreasing while the current IA is increasing, does that mean the induced torque changes or not? Actually, there will be the system will reach a new steady state point. We need to see here now that since IA is decreasing, IA is increasing, but flux phi is decreasing, what happens to the induced torque? So what we are saying here is that phi is decreasing, IA is increasing. What will happen to the induced torque? This is increasing, this is decreasing. Now will the net effect be that torque induced increases or torque induced decreases? We see in case of DC motor, because of the rating of the resistances, because of the windings and the design of the DC motor, there is not a proportional decrease in flux and a proportional increase in armature current. What we see that a 1% decrease in flux produces a 49% increase in armature current. So what have that means actually armature, the increase in armature current is much more as compared to the decrease in flux. So in nutshell, because of a larger increase in IA, torque induced increases. So coming back to the discussion, as IA will increase, that means induced torque increases. When induced torque increases, that means the motor will now speed up. Once the motor speeds up, that means now omega also increases. This implies that omega increases. Now increase in omega means increase in back EMF. That means again a decrease in armature resistance. So this is actually an internal stability in a DC machine, that one component leads to an increase in a particular parameter of the system, but simultaneously some other parameter in the system varies in such a fashion to get the system back to stability. So now IA is back decreasing, that means torque induced will again decrease and actually achieve a new steady state point. So what happens in nutshell is that, to summarize this thing, we are increasing the field resistance, that will increase the field current, that will decrease the field current. Decreased flux, decreased field current means decreased flux. Decreased flux means decreased back EMF induced in the armature. Decreased back EMF means actually an increase in the armature current. As the armature current increase is more as compared to the flux decrease, the torque induced will increase. That means the change in IA is dominant over the change in flux. An increased torque will mean that the motor will speed up. As the motor speeds up, that means the back EMF again will increase. That means the back EMF increase, that again results in the decrease in IA. Decreased IA will make sure that torque induced decrease back to its to the value of the load, to the rated value of the load torque. So the speed of the motor is increasing, but what happens is also there is a speed, there is an increase in speed, but the torque induced balance is set back to the low torque. So an increase in field resistance will changing the field resistance, that means we are actually increasing the field resistance, has led to increase in speed of the DC motor. So a decrease in field resistance will mean the speed of the motor will decrease, while torque induced will fall back to its value such that induced torque is equal to the load torque. Fine. So this is the method of adjusting the field resistance by changing the field resistance. Now what will happen by changing the armature voltage? The process is almost somewhat can be expected now. What will happen? Ia is Vt minus Eb, Vt minus Eb divided by Ra. So in this case, we are actually increasing the armature voltage of the DC machine. So increased armature voltage means increased armature current. As the armature current increases, that will mean the torque induced in this case, which is actually equal to, which is directly proportional to Ia, will also increase. Vt is increasing. Vt is increasing. We are increasing Vt. That means Ia increases. That implies induced torque in the machine increases as well. With the increased torque, we say that speed increases. Now, torque induced has become greater than the low torque. With increased speed, we know now that since back EMF is proportional to increased speed, Eb will increase. As Eb also increases, Vt has also increased. The net effect will be that Ia will return back to its nominal value, while torque steady state value, Ia will reach to its now steady state value, and torque induced will be equal to torque load. So again, by increasing the armature voltage, we can increase the speed of the induction machine, of the DC machine. But simultaneously, the balance will be restored back in the system. Steady state will be restored back into the system, and torque induced will now be again equal to the low torque. So what here is happening is that we are increasing the armature voltage input. That increases the armature current, that increases the induced torque, that induced torque increases the speed. Increased speed means back EMF will increase. Back EMF increase means the armature current will again decrease. A decreased armature means torque induced will decrease back to the load torque. While this does take place, that this in balanced between the induced torque and the load torque will now be at a higher speed. Another method of, as I said to you, the third method of increasing the speed in case of changing the speed in case of a DC motor, DC shunt motor, is by inserting a resistance in series with the armature circuit. The increase, if since the if the resistor is inserted in series with the armature circuit, the effect will be actually there will be an increase in the slope of the motor's torque speed characteristics. That will make it operate more slowly if loaded. We have already seen the torque speed characteristics of a DC motor. The torque speed characteristics of a DC motor look something, DC shunt motor looks something like this. So that means we have now an increased slope. The motor will look something like this now. So as the armature, as the series resistance is increased, the increase in the slope of the motor's torque speed characteristics will make the motor operate slowly if loaded more. It is as such, it's a wasteful method of speed control, since the losses in the armature windings will also increase. IRA drop will also increase. This is the actual reason that we actually, for this very reason, we do not prefer to use this method, wherein we are inserting a resistance in series with the armature resistance. Note that with increased voltage, there will also be an increased IARA drop. As RA increases and current also increases, IARA drop will be more significant as compared to a case where there was a lesser value of RA. So with greater value of IARA drop, the loading will actually make the system more slow. So there are two methods. We can use either the field control method by inserting the field resistance, by varying the field resistance, and another method is the armature voltage control method, simply changing the voltage input of a DC machine. Now this is how we control the speed in case of a DC shunt motor. Now speed control of series DC motor. A DC series motor, we know that RA and RF, the field driver resistance and the armature resistance, they are in series. So inserting an armature resistance, inserting an armature, here adjusting the field resistance is as good as adjusting the armature resistance. That means we are actually again increasing the IARA losses. So in this case, the speed control method using field by adjust the field resistance is also not feasible. So there is the only method of speed control of DC series motors is adjusting the speed via armature voltage. In case of a DC series motor, the armature resistance and the field resistance are in series. So increasing field resistance is as good as increasing the armature resistance in here. So whatever effects were because of increased armature resistance, that is increased IRA drop, the same will be the case in case of increased field resistance in case of a DC series motor. So the only feasible solution, only feasible method is by adjusting the armature voltage. So by the effect will be same. We will increase the speed, we'll increase the armature voltage. The effect will be IA will increase, increased IA, the same effect as we discussed in case of DC shunt motors. We are increasing the applied voltage, that's we are increasing the terminal voltage. That actually means IA increases. IA increase means torque induced will increase. Torque induced increase means omega will increase. With an increase in omega, EB, the back EMF will increase. An increase in EB will make sure that IA falls back. That means torque induced will fall back. So torque induced will fall back and become equal to the load torque at a higher speed. So these are the speed control methods of DC shunt motors and DC series motors. Now we know that the torque speed characteristics of a DC shunt motor and the separately excited DC motor are same. So the methods adopted in DC shunt motor are the same methods adopted in case of DC separately excited DC motors as well. Now there is one important problem with DC series motors, that since the field winding and the armature winding are in series, the starting current in case of a DC motor will be high as compared to that of DC shunt motors. So we use starters in case of DC series motors. Now, what the effect of starters is to limit actually the flow of current through the DC motor. So the starter will actually protect the motor against damage due to short circuit. It will protect the motor against overloads as well as against the excessive starting currents. So what happens in the case of a DC series motor is that the motor is not turning, and so the back EMF is zero. As we know that if omega is zero, the back EMF induced will also be zero in a DC series motor. The normal resistance, that is the armature resistance, is very less, as is very low compared to the field resistance. Now, in case of a DC series motor, the field resistance is in series with the armature resistance. So what happens here is that even with a low value of RA, we are saying initially EA is zero, the back EMF is zero. So if EA has a very low value, 0.01, and terminal voltage is 200, that means we can assume that IA will be 200 by 0.01. That's a kilos of amperes of current is flowing through the DC motor. The general, we are discussing a general case first for DC motor. So for all DC motors, this is true, that the starting current is very high. So we need starters. Starters will protect the motor against damage due to this excessive starting current. So one method of So what is the starter? It will simply be using a resistance in series with the armature winding. So this is the armature winding. We can use a pack of resistances in series. They will be connected through switches. So what we do here is that so initially R1, R2, R3, all the three resistances will be into play. That means the effective resistance of the armature is very large. So initially the current will be low. As the motor will start turning, EA will start increasing. That means VT minus EA will start reducing drastically. So as VT minus EA reduces, we can start turning off the resistances one by one. R1, R2 and R3 using switch combination, using centrifugal switch or whatever mechanism we are using. This starter will thus limit the current flowing through the armature of the of the DC motor. Now this effect is more predominant in case of DC series motors, where the starting current is much larger. So in case of DC series motors, the effect of starting current needs to be taken into consideration more as compared to other DC motor types. So this is all about DC motors. We have discussed today the speed control strategies associated with the DC motors. In case of shunt motors, we can use field resistances and the armature voltage, and by changing the armature voltage. In case of DC series motors, we adopt only the armature voltage method. Also, we have seen, because of initially the current starting current in DC motors is very large, and it's even more large in case of DC series motors, because there's effectively no parallel path through which the current will flow. In case of DC shunt motors, there's a parallel path through which current gets divided. In case of DC series motor, it is more the starting current is much larger, much more larger. So we need to take into consideration this how we can effectively reduce the starting current, and for that we use starters. Starters are simply as simple as a combination of resistors that can be inserted in a series with the armature that can be turned off one by one. As far as the losses in DC motors are concerned, there are some. We have already studied the losses in DC in induction motors. Similarly, there are copper losses, core losses, and mechanical losses, and the brush drop losses in case of DC motors. The principle is same. Copper losses because of the armature resistance. Core losses because of the magnetic nature of the system, and stray losses or mechanical losses are because of the friction windings extra. So this wraps up our DC motor. We'll start with synchronous machines in the next session.